The Mini-Hub is a vertical polarized antenna. It is a kind of ground plane antenna. The upper PCB surface part is the actual antenna and the lower PCB surface part is the ground plane and contains an impedance converter. The voltage difference between the upper and the lower PCB surfaces is fed to the BNC bus out. The converter adapts the 7 megaohm HiZ antenna to the 50 ohms BNC bus out. The PCB ground connection point must be connected to a dedicated noise-free ground. The BNC coax bus should not be grounded. The properties of my improved mini-whip. Well suited for VLF to VHF reception, low noise floor, high IP, flat bandwidth 10 kHz to 150 MHz. The antenna input is guarded against overvoltage, resistive output impedance of 50 ohms. Noise filter DC power input connection protected against overvoltage, wrong polarity and short circuits. Every vertical polarized antenna is suited for reception of VLF, long wave, medium wave and short wave DX. Every vertical polarized antenna is not suited for reception of ENVIS signals, which are reflected at 90 degrees towards the Earth surface by an avalayer. A mini-whip is therefore not suited for ENVIS reception between 3 MHz and 8 MHz and distances up to 350 km. This frequency characteristic is measured at my mini-whip version 2018. Using a NanoVNA and NanoVNA software. Channel 0 is the generator output terminated with 50 ohms. Channel 1 is the NanoVNA receiver input, which also is terminated with 50 ohms. The 7 picofarad capacitor represents the coupling capacitance between the RF field and the antenna surface. The common motor choke over the return coax ensures better decoupling between channel 0 and channel 1, resulting in better low level performance. The minus 3 dB bandwidth is about 8 kHz to 150 MHz. A whip antenna can be connected to a hole in the antenna surface to boost signal levels. This is my unique in 2018 developed new dual gate MOSFET input circuit for a source follower. It realizes very low distortion even when the MOSFET is driven near saturation. Both gates get individual DC bias with an optimal DC voltage difference between gate 1 and gate 2. Set for optimal steepness, linearity and allowable source current. For RF signals, gates 1 and 2 are connected in parallel. When driven with RF signals of large amplitude, the voltage difference between gate 1 and gate 2 will not vary. Even when driven to nearly saturation, the steepness of the MOSFET will remain totally constant. The results are supreme linearity and drive capability. Both gates are protected against overvoltage by internal and external clamping diodes. The clamping currents to both gates are limited to safe values by the gate series resistors. These resistors also keep the stage stable by limiting its upper frequency range to about 200 MHz. The emitter follower output stage transistor is a very linear SHF power transistor, especially developed for cable network amplifiers. Its bias is optimally set for low distortion and maximal output. The series resistor at the base also limits the bandwidth of this stage, again to ensure stability. The common modus choke is a balancing device to change the unbalanced emitter output to balanced coax output. As the output impedance of the output transistor is less than 1 ohm, a series resistor has to be inserted to define the antenna output impedance to the correct standard 50 ohms value. Instability and reflections due to bad VSWR are thus prevented. However, this costs 6 dB voltage gain. Simple circuits can therefore have less gain loss, thereby sacrificing stability and a flat frequency characteristic. A mini RIP absolutely needs a low Z and noise-free grounding. At the same time, the grounding point at my MiniRip PCB is the only grounding point in the whole antenna system. Both transistors are cooled in contact with the PCB surface. A little warming up is normal and helps preventing condensation inside the antenna housing. Keep therefore antenna power always connected. At the top of the antenna PCB is a notch for easy gluing into a PVC top cap. An extra rib can be connected here too. Install coax buses onto the outside of the aluminium box. This ensures that the box acts as a cage of Faraday, preventing pin 1 problems. Two film capacitors in parallel ensure wide bandwidth coupling. Two chokes with different series resonance frequencies construct a wideband choke. This is a filter which blocks noises possibly coming from the power supply. A Zener diode protects against overvoltage and wrong polarity. An extra choke inserted between the chassis power bus and the PCB power connection prevents the import of power supply noises. A wire connects the PCB grounding point to a grounded metal mast. This is one way to securely clamp a MiniRip 40mm PVC pipe housing onto a round metal mast. Use two U-shaped pieces of aluminium screwed back to back together. The whole MiniRip should be above the top of the mast. It takes effort to accomplish the best possible MiniRip performance and best signal to noise ratio. Without the following measures, you will experience disappointing performance. All shown measures are needed for optimal signal-to-noise ratio. Important: the antenna PCB must be grounded. Install every 3 meters distance a common modus choke at the coax transmission line. In order to make cabinet screening effective, all flanges of coax buses must make good electrical contact with the outside of the cabinets. The minus of the 12V DC must be insulated from the outside of the power supply cabinet. The main safety ground wire should only be connected to the outside of the cabinet. Modify it if needed. Also check at your SDR receiver that the antenna bus makes good electrical contact with the housing. Install a copper motor choke over the USB connection cable. To prevent a ground loop, do not ground the PC or the laptop. This is a picture from an article by Papa Alpha 3 Fox Whiskey Mike. The copper motor choke on the MiniWIP PCB wound with RG174 coax. On the bottom right, the only grounding point for the whole antenna system. A copper motor choke wound with thin RG316 in a snap-it core from ferrite. Two examples. On the left side, a coax copper motor choke wound with thin PTFE coax. On the right, a bifilar copper motor choke wound with two wires in parallel. Both are usable in coax systems. Twisted wires are not acceptable. Another example, a twisted pair from a UTP cable can also be used. This is handy for chokes in receiving systems. A choke wound over a thin USB cable. A cheap linear power supply. Most of these are equipped with a plastic fully insulated Euro power bus. The ground lead in the power cord is connected to the central pin of it and directly fed onto the PCB. The problem is that noises on the ground lead directly are imported to the electronics. One way is to separate the ground wire and connect it to the outside of the cabinet. Another way is to replace the insulated power bus by one incorporating a mains noise filter. When this is screwed to the outside of the box, the ground surface of the filter is connected to the outside of the box. Do not connect the grounding pin which is on the inside of the cabinet. This filter has a respectable suppression of common mode and differential mode noises. To block noises at the mains outlet, special transformers are sometimes used. They can be very expensive. A cheaper solution is installing a good mains noise filter. Here a Schaffner version. The common mode and the differential mode suppression are very good. As the noise coming from the mains must be blocked, such a filter should be connected in reverse, and its ground connection must only be connected to a separate noise-free ground. Installation. The success of reception with a MiniWIP antenna fully depends on your following of all these installation instructions. Find a low noise location for the MiniWIP, which enables also a short connection to a separate low noise electrical ground. Use a wideband radio to find the spot. Install the antenna there on a metal pole as high as possible, as far away from noise sources as possible. The metal pole is your grounding connection. Connect the pole to the antenna PCB grounding point and ground the pole. The coax transmission line. Use thin coax, RG316 or RG174. Start at the splitter and wind every 3 meters distance the coax at least 12 times through a ferrite snap-it ferrite core. Each Komamoto shell consumes about 1 meter coax length. You could bury the coax 15 centimeters deep into the soil, which also helps suppressing Komamoto noises. Protect it against water intrusion. Avoid running the coax near radio noise sources, like mains cables, plus smart TV, PLC, switch motor power supplies. Further denoising. Install CMCs over the following cables. The USB connection to a PC. Mains power cords and DC power cords of all power supplies, PCs and laptops. Important, correct all pin 1 problems. Correct all mains grounding of power supplies. Install mains noise filters. Correction of sensitivity differences. This antenna will give about 18 decibel less signal compared with a dipole antenna. This difference easily can be corrected in the used SDR software. Adjust the software gain of the SDR software so that 15 to 20 dB more signal strength indication is the result. You always need at least 12 dB attenuation to prevent, during evening hours, saturation of wideband SDR receiving units. Again, the differences between a mini-whip and a good loop antenna. A mini-whip needs grounding. My wideband RX loop needs no grounding. A mini-whip is sensitive to radiated e-field noises. My RX loop is only sensitive to magnetic fields. A mini-whip is not sensitive for ENVIS signals. My wideband RX loop is sensitive for DX and ENVIS signals. My wideband RX loop enables up to 30 dB suppression of a noise source by turning its axis towards that noise source.